to talk to you about why I wrote about Queen Victoria, what myths there were in place about her, and how I went about trying to chip away at the edifice of myth and propaganda and misunderstanding that I believe had shrouded her and led to a misunderstanding of her for such a long time. And because we're in France, I'm going to start off talking about sex. And the pivotal question that I addressed was whether was Queen Victoria Victorian? Now the best way, one of the best ways to assess this is to think about what was then the stuff of many women's nightmares, the wedding night. Victoria was 20, she was jittery, she was anxious about losing her autonomy. She had some fabulous years out of her mother's clutches and before she got married. She very much enjoyed being single, hosting many balls, inviting the likes of Felix Mendelssohn, and dancing the night away with handsome men. She was anxious. She'd lost weight, which she worried made her look drawn, and so she consulted her then Prime Minister, Lord Melbourne. And it's quite an interesting insight into their relationship, actually, which was quite avuncular, bordering on romantic, and yet very intimate. She'd lost her father when she was 8 months old. And here was this man, and she said to him, I'm worried. Basically, she was saying to him, I'm worried that I'm not going to look beautiful on my wedding day. And he says to her, no, 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 you look very well. And he said, in fact, you have a large, searching eye and an open, anxious nostril. It's like, is that the best you could do? He repeated it several times, praising her nostrils, and tears were rolling down his face. He was quite the crier, Lord Melbourne. He said, it's a very true representation, and there can't be a finer physiognomy. Of course, few women today would be flattered to hear they have large and anxious nostrils. The Queen smiled happily and said, I'm sure none of your friends are as fond of you as I am. And he said, I believe not. Her wedding night went on to exceed all of her expectations. She wrote, I never, never spent such an evening. My dearest, dear Albert sat on a footstool by my side. And his excessive love and affection gave me feelings of heavenly love and happiness. I could never have hoped to have felt before. He clasped me in his arms and we kissed each other again and again. The happiest day of my life. In the early days of their marriage, Victoria really spoke about Albert as though he was a beautiful wife that she wanted to gaze upon. She described him with a kind of lustful enchantment. Over breakfast, she would write in her diary how she gazed at him, noticing he had no neckcloth on under his black velvet jacket. He was more beautiful, she said, than it's possible for me to say. She had proposed to him, by the way, three days after seeing him and just being completely struck by his beauty, by his shoulders, by his spreading out, by his fine moustache, which she made everyone in the army wear. She was so taken with it. The next day, after their marriage, she said, I feel a purer, more unearthly feeling than I ever did. And she loved the intimate gestures the most, when Albert put on her stockings for her and when she watched him shave, fascinated. Now, historians have long acknowledged that Victoria had a high libido. Some have implied she was some kind of sexual predator who devoured her tolerant husband. But this hasn't come into public consciousness today. So strongly is Victoria associated with a kind of dour old age and puritanical condemnation. Given how fraught sex was at the time for women, there was limited access to contraception and abortion and no pain relief for childbirth. Victoria's unbridled and unabashed physical enjoyment of her husband is remarkable. If we go back to the 19th century, it was assumed women were naturally not as interested in sex as men. And most of their illnesses were thought to derive from their troublesome pelvic organs. Female desire was considered dangerous, potentially explosive. It was thought that women's animal natures would overwhelm weak wills, and they would, when touched and excited, lose all physical control over themselves. Women were dubbed and classified as nymphomaniacs for dreaming, thinking about, or having what was considered considered to be an excessive amount of sex. And there were various extreme responses to this, including the places of leeches. Some were told to abstain from meat and brandy, use hair pillows, or adhere to strict vegetable diets. And here's a great example of the projection which was prevalent in the Victorian medical industry. In 1886, a doctor reported the most likely candidates for nymphomania were virgins, widows, or women with blonde hair between the ages of 16 and 25. Another example of projection, by the way, is that one of the arguments which was used by doctors at the time against pain relief for women in childbirth was that they would be physically overwhelmed and try to, you know, make romantic overtures towards the doctor while giving birth, which any woman in this room who's had that experience knows is not particularly likely. Now, reliable information about sexual intercourse then was sparse and often non-existent. And the relationship between a male doctor and female patient was considered particularly fraught. There was much concern about what was called speculum mania. But the greatest sources of knowledge about female organs were thought to be male gynecologists who made the secrets of women's bodies just their secrets for themselves. And this made sex education for girls unthinkable. Mothers would be the ones usually to pass the knowledge on to their daughters, but Victoria was not speaking to hers. Even by 1900, a year before Victoria died, the advice, this is sexual advice for young women. The seed of life is entrusted by God to the father in a very wonderful way. And after marriage, he is allowed to give it to his wife. So this is the context in which Victoria told her Prime Minister that Albert's kindness and affection was beyond everything, who said plaintively to her doctor when he told her when at the age of 38, and she'd had 9 children, that she should have no more, who said to him, "Am I to have no more fun in bed?" I don't know if anyone here has been to Osborne House, which is in the Isle of Wight, and it's miraculous, it's preserved. It was their holiday home, and it's preserved beautifully from the moment that Victoria died. You can still see a little plaster cast of the children's hands. Albert, of course, designed most of the things to do with the house. The garden, the sanitation system, the Swiss cottage where the children were taught to cook, a tent for Victoria by the sea, the nursery, billiard table, which is quite a bit higher than the usual billiard table so that women wouldn't lean over and come out of their dresses. It was actually Albert who was the Puritan in that relationship. There's a painting in the yellow drawing room, which Victoria, it was the first that Victoria gave to Albert. I was staring at it when a guy came up to me and said, "You might want to look very closely at that. That painter often left secrets in his paintings." And when you look at it, so there's 3 women, and it's in summers, it's an afternoon picnic, one of those idyllic days, green grass, sun coming down. One of them's holding a parasol, another one's sitting there, and one of them is lying back, looking blissful. I stared and stared at the painting until finally I could see that from under that woman's skirt was coming another pair of shoes. And you can see the outline of a man's back. So that was a painting that Victoria gave to Albert. That suggests that in many ways that we currently assume she was not as Victorian as we would suggest. So who was Queen Victoria and how did she come to be buried in plain sight? Some, of course, have blamed the statues of her throughout the Commonwealth, which have done her absolutely no favours over time. She looks so grim. In 1919, the editors of the Arts Gazette decided to ask readers to nominate the ugliest statue in London. Now, George Bernard Shaw responded to this, and he said very respectfully, he admired Victoria's determination and panache, but that there were many of her statues that would qualify. He wondered what crime Queen Victoria committed that she should be so horribly guyed as she has been throughout the length and breadth of her dominions. It was part of her personality, he said, that she was a tiny woman, and our national passion for telling lies in every public subject has led to her being represented as an overgrown monster. Victoria had great decision of manner, a beautiful speaking voice, which she used in public extremely well. She carried herself very well, but he lamented, all young people now believe she was a huge heap of a woman. Now, the task of a historian is much like that of an archaeologist. That what we're chipping through is myth instead of rock, we shed assumptions and errors instead of dust. Initially, I thought my greatest responsibility as biographer was to expose how the many fictions of Victoria have clouded our understanding of her. But in trying to do so, I have hoped to uncover new information and new fragments. I didn't expect to be, 115 years after she died, still thwarted, censored, and perplexed by the secrecy of the royal archivists entrusted with preserving the royal memory. And, as it turns out, the respectability of a queen long past. For in truth, the history of the royal family is blotted with bonfires, vast piles of letters, mounds of correspondence, piled in courtyards, set alight, thrown into fireplaces. The evidence of the secret whisperings, the shameful liaisons, deep prejudices, the embarrassing alliances. I had to spend the better part of a year consulting lawyers on how to best preserve and publish the new fragments I found, while simultaneously marvelling at how they managed to escape the flames at all. But I'll come to this. The irony, of course, is that Victoria was not just a great communicator, writing millions of words over her lifetime, an average of about 2,500 a day is the conservative estimate. 60 million words over her lifetime, if you want to know why it took me so long. She was a great preserver of correspondence also. But now so much of her work has actually been tampered with, you need to spend a considerable amount of time working out what is not there as well as what is there. So they were my challenges, questioning the myths and the evidence. Now, oddly enough, I first began thinking about Queen Victoria during the 2008 American election, the presidential campaign. I was working with my former colleague, Dana Thomas, and we were covering Hillary Clinton, Sarah Palin, and we're having constant arguments in our editorial meetings about how we thought of women with power. I'd done a PhD on the subject and concluded that for women in power, we too often think of it as incongruous, as water and oil, or as when it's exercised somehow being either surprising or secondary, derived to someone near them. Some, for example, in Victoria's example, in Victoria's case, her prime ministers and her husband, or as severe, as excessively severe. The Iron Lady is a classic example, the iron fist in the velvet glove, the steel magnolia, all these words that imply that it's a contradiction in terms to be a woman in a position of power. By the way, Queen Victoria, I mean, if you'll remember that Donald Trump called Hillary Clinton a nasty woman, there is no doubt that he would have said the same thing of Queen Victoria. William Gladstone said, being alone in a room with the Queen is enough to kill any man. And Otto von Bismarck walked out of his meeting with her, mopping his brow, according to observers, saying, my God, what a woman. One could do business with her. She was also actually the subject of more violence than other monarchs were, the subject of 8 assassination attempts over her lifetime, which really struck me that this had not happened to the king. She was bold, she was defiant, she continued to go out in her open carriage on the same day that she'd been shot at. She turned up at the opera with sporting a black eye. She was literally clubbed in the head. And this did not escape some of the female poets at the time, who said, what could have happened to our tiny queen that she should be the subject of such violence? And not to the king's. But that's a subject for another time. So back to Newsweek. My editor, John Meacham, suggested to me that the Queen Victoria had not been examined for some time properly. I went off to the New York Society Library. Has anyone worked there? I bet you have, Dana. It's the most fantastic little library in New York up near the Met. And I discovered by reading everything, all the contemporaneous accounts of Victoria, that there had been an unvarying repetition of the same views of her, with rare, fresh interrogation of new material, and this piqued my interest. I was so surprised to find a funny, sprightly, progressive, passionate, and robust mother and woman. He'd been buried under a pile of mess created by observers, sycophants, Republicans, monarchists, and herself, and bolstered by the royal family ever since. Miss, like when Albert died, she effectively died too, but when she was in her widow's weeds, she was simply inactive and hidden in Scotland instead of bombarding the ministers of the crown with letters every single day demanding to be heard. Myths that she was an impeccably constitutional and well-behaved queen, not one who, say, corresponded directly with generals in the field telling them how to conduct the war, for which she was actually rebuked, but nonetheless. That she was a simple product of the men who advised her and shaped her, her Pygmalions. And of course that her servant John Brown was just a good friend. There was a myth that she ruled only with the help of her husband, that she truly believed women had no place in the public sphere, yet she was a bad and cruel mother. Our expectations of motherhood are so interesting when we look at how we sorely judge a queen in ways that kings are not. A BBC series recently called her a domestic tyrant, was the title of it. Honestly, they missed about three decades of her journals in coming up with that assumption. The myth was that she was a severe, stout, humourless woman, perennially unamused, who mourned without effectively ruling for four decades, a black-clad, sad lump on top of the coal heap of political life. And of course, she was also unfairly associated with Victorian Puritanism. Now, Osborne House was just one of the places that I explored. Since I began the project, I dug through material from archives in Scotland, London, Oxford, Sydney, Germany, America, in a bid to find out who Victoria was. Poring over dusty documents, deciphering appalling handwriting, especially towards the end of her life, and decoding hieroglyphics, literally code, in aging leather journals, I walked slowly and repeatedly in the home through the rooms of the home she lived in, Osborne House on the Isle of Wight, Windsor Castle, Buckingham Palace, Balmoral Castle in Scotland. I think Balmoral was its most revealing, actually, not for the tartan furnishings, which apparently were horrendous. They called it tartanitis because every single thing was tartan, or her many portraits of her beloved dogs, but for its sense of soothing, wild remoteness. Even today, I think it is like that, even though so many of the portraits we see of the royal family there seemed tame. It was a wild and comforting place for her to be. And in all of this exploration, I found Victoria battled with many of the matters we do today. Managing uneven relationships, placating resentful spouses, trying to raise decent children, battling her own bouts of insecurity and depression, spending years, you could argue her whole life, recovering from childbirth, yearning for loves that were lost and then found and then lost again, and longing to make decisions about her own life and shape the world we live in. I was really surprised by her wicked sense of humour. It was so slapstick. Her dislike of pretension, her candour, her tolerance of different religions, intolerance of prejudice, and her intense, enduring involvement in politics, ordering around ministers, trying to keep Lord Melbourne in power, trying to keep William Gladstone out of power, unsuccessfully in that case. And a woman who wrote a letter every year to the Elephant Man, a woman who found out that when the tallest man in the world was marrying the tallest woman, she invited them to the palace and gave them a wedding ring and a dress, which would have been quite a sight because she was under 5 foot tall. I found that she had adored her husband completely, and yet her belief that he was superior in every way undermined her self-esteem. So when he died, she was entirely lacking in self-confidence and anxious about public appearances. I don't know if anyone's been watching The Crown, but that's it's an enduring thing for the Queen, Queen Elizabeth as well, the second. How to manage restless husbands who feel somewhat emasculated by your job. And one of the great things I found in the Royal Archives, which I'll mention in a moment, is memoranda between Victoria and Albert. When they fought, they wrote memos and passed it through the private secretary. And this could go on for many days. And there remains a box of the memos there now that Princess Beatrice, Victoria's youngest daughter, tried to have destroyed in World War II. You can see the correspondence between the librarians, that she'd come across this, how inappropriate that this should be there, and could they please burn them. They decided they would send them back to her so she could, in fact, burn them, but someone took a photograph of them and they remained there intact. I don't know who that rebellious librarian or archivist was, but to them I'm very grateful. And you get such wonderful insights into the relationship of this man and woman, the woman who had temper tantrums since she was just a toddler that her husband called combustibles, and the cool, Germanic, rational thinker. She would flame into fury, then go back to her room and write so many contrite. She was absolutely sorry, and she would never do it again, and could they possibly make up? And he would take days to cool down. And he'd write her this advice, number one, if you applied some logic to your thinking, Victoria, we would all greatly benefit. Number two, would you please stop following me from room to room when we argue? The dynamic of their relationship over time is fascinating. I also found that she loved her Highland servant, John Brown, one of the most speculated on relationships in history. She deeply, truly loved him, to the extent that when she guiltily consulted a priest about missing Albert a little less, and he had to tell her not to worry, she called him her best friend. And when he died, she was bereft for the second time in her life. She spoke about the relationship like it was the second major relationship of her life. She likened it directly to the loss of Albert. It was in my quest to find out what the true nature of her relationship with this much gossiped about man was, a man who her family called the Queen's Stallion, a man, a giant of a man who called her woman, teased her about her weight, which made her laugh, who drank and swore and devoted his life to the Queen. And in doing so, I ended up in a large stone home in a village called Lanton in the Scottish Highlands, Lowlands. Here there are the most fantastic archives, meticulous records of his two decades of service to the Queen, newspaper clippings, funeral services, and most importantly, his diary. I read his account of Victoria's death and was incredibly moved by his palpable grief. She also died in his arms. She trusted him so much and she valued him so much. He had one arm around her, and Kaiser Wilhelm II had his other arm around her. Of course, he would be at war with England just over a decade later. I read about his report about the impact of the childbirth had had on her body, something that was only discovered because he examined her for the first time on her deathbed. I also found that this doctor had taken a careful, particular interest in her relationship with John Brown. Part of this was doubtless due to the fact that he was later entrusted by King Edward VII to deal with a blackmailer who had got his hands on 200 letters Victoria had written to the manager of the estate in Balmoral about John Brown. 200 letters. Dr. James Reid got a large sum of money, went to visit him, purchased the letters, and burnt them. What we know, though, is he said that he wrote in his diary simply that these were very compromising letters. Part of the reason he was so interested in her relationship with John Brown was due to things he had witnessed, exchanges between the pair. And bear with me when I tell you about this fragment I discovered, because it seems odd at first sound. And it had not been published before, this strange reference I found in a corner, right, so he had this tiny little journal, leather bound, and he put in just perfunctory notes. Went to Victoria ill, temperature, not Victoria Queen. And then he would say, rode his bike, visited his wife, who occasionally got a look in, his job father's doctor to the Queen was very demanding, and the medicine he administered. But on one day, on the right-hand side of this page, written in very abbreviated words, almost code, he wrote down an encounter that he witnessed between the Queen and John Brown. Opening the door to Victoria's room on Thursday, the 22nd of March, 1883, he said he saw her flirting with John Brown as she walked a little. Brown says to her, lifting his kilt, "Oh, I thought it was here." Victoria then lifts her skirt and says, "No, no, no, it is here." Now, obviously it is unclear what "it is" from this. And of course the Scottish were so thrilled by this. The Scotsman reported it when my book came out with this massive front page headline, "Scotsman exposes himself to the Queen," which was not my intention in telling this story. It may have been her sore knee, it may have been a bruise. What it does reveal is a remarkable level of intimacy between then even a woman and a male friend, let alone a woman and a servant, or a monarch and her servant. And what's significant is that he recorded it and how he recorded it. Now, part of Sir James' interest in John Brown was also the fact that he was the person the Queen trusted with her deepest secrets, what she would be buried with. This is why I ended up in these archives in Scotland. She's written in her own hand instructions for what she wanted put in her coffin and how she wanted to be buried. It was to be kept in the pocket of her dresser at all times, and on the moment of her death to be given to Sir James, her doctor, not to go through her family, not to be viewed by her children, but specifically to be kept away from their eyes. It was a long list of objects she wanted in her coffin: mementos from her children, photographs of her grandchildren, jewellery from Albert, her sister Theodore, her mother, her daughters Louise and Beatrice. She also asked that a plaster cast of Albert's hand be placed, a photo of Albert being next to her, which she kept with her since he had died. A photo of her, a lock of Albert's hair, a photo of him, and a photo in this hand. In this hand, a photo of John Brown, a lock of his hair, and his mother's wedding ring. That was then to be wrapped in gauze, so her family never saw it, and flowers were placed over it by Sir James, so that again, anyone proceeding past the casket would not see what was in her hand. Queen Victoria had been wearing the wedding ring ever since he gave it to her, and ever since the moment of his death in particular. I thought this was very significant. We must remember also that her shielding of her family from this, who had at times greatly resented his access to the Queen and her comfort with the Queen, his coarseness, and the fact that he was served as an intermediary sometimes, and the fact that it was so gossiped about in this country, first of all, actually, what she called Mrs. Brown. Only one person had ever published part of this 20 years ago. So equipped with all of this, while I was meanwhile going around all of these archives, I was trying to get into what for me was the holy grail, the Royal Archives. I naively assumed that I would be, having a PhD in history, what I thought was a reputable profession, that I would be able to get in. I wrote several letters promising to treat the material in a scholarly and cautious fashion. I was rebuffed. I was told, "You have not written royal history before. This is your first biography." And to give some context on this, the Royal Archives is not ever transparent about who they let in and why. They don't have to be transparent, they're run by the royal household. And I bumped into someone at a function just recently from Australia's biggest selling women's magazine called The Women's Weekly, who came up to me and said, "Oh, I loved my time at the Royal Archives when I was doing my books." I was like, "Oh, I should have just published more stories on the Queen, which would have been perhaps a better And it was not until at a random dinner organised by the Governor General of Australia, the Queen's representative in our country, that her private secretary, who's actually here as French ambassador at the moment, Stephen Brady, found out about it and pressed my cause with Queen Elizabeth II's private secretary and was able to get me in. I was absolutely delighted. It felt such an honour. They're held in the Round Tower of Windsor Castle. You have to climb, after getting through all the security, you're told to dress appropriately, you have to wear the right footwear, you have to present your passport, you have to, as I said, you walk up 100 stairs. And at the top, someone will be waiting for you, take you to a tiny room, and there you will have these letters. Now, mind you, there's no index, so you have to guess what's there. And some of her boxes are just completely closed. Her daughter Louise, who married a man who preferred the company of women, so had several affairs herself, and was supposed to be she was certainly in the presence. It's not sure if she was in the embrace of the famous sculptor Edward Byam at the moment that he died. That box is closed. Someone wrote a biography of her without accessing any of that, which just seems unfathomable to me. But to see her handwriting, her emphasis, her thick scrawl, she italicizes and double underlines. I corrected a bunch of errors that I'd found had been repeated in other biographies. I found some new material of my own. And they're very, very careful about the material. And you are, for example, accompanied to the bathroom so that you don't make off with any... Has anyone had that experience at any other archives? I think it's so extraordinary. But the worst thing is you'll be sitting in this little room and if it's only just you and the archivist, cheek by jowl, that's okay. If there's someone else in the room, they'll have to get someone to come and escort you. So speaking into the intercom, the librarian will say, which goes all the way around the Round Tower in this echo, Dr. Baird needs to go to the bathroom. Again, could someone please come and escort her? That is the end of... And if everyone just dehydrates when they go to the archives after that. It was wonderful. Something ripped together. Before you start work there, you have to sign a contract that ensures you're aware they have absolute control of the material that you're about to use. You agree to send many sections of your text, which are based on Royal Archives material, showing the relevant passages in the context of the surrounding paragraphs or two of your commentary. I used so much archival material that when I got to the end, I sent them my manuscript. And I waited for a very long time, several months, before I got a response. And so when I did finally receive a response, I was very glad for it. Some of it was corrections of citations in very particular ways that the archives had it. One strange querying of, could you say that if she was depressed for a long period after the birth of her child, whether that was postnatal depression, which I thought was interesting. I'm not sure if there's still an issue with stigma surrounding that. But what they asked me to do, they okayed everything I used from the Royal Archives, but they asked me to cut out anything I'd had from Dr. James Reid's material and anything to do with Victoria and John Brown from that. You can imagine the quandary. wanting to be respectful and wanting to, at the same time, not accede to censorship and control of documents I'd cited with my own eyes that were in other collections, in the hands of other people, that perhaps really only show the Queen to be human. And obviously, when you're writing history, the task that we set ourselves is to hack through myths, not to hew to them, as I said at the beginning. So in came the lawyers in several countries to query it, and so we could work through what the issue was. And honestly, there is no... I can talk at length about probably too much length about that, but there's no contractual obligation. They asked me to do something I had never signed to when I agreed to use those archives. So since publication, I've heard not a peep, and it's been fine. I included the material of our respected copyright, and I informed the Palace of Might and the archives of my decision. But the Times of London has been very strongly arguing the case, prosecuting the case, that we need more access for historians to those archives. We need more transparency, and we need to be able to understand in full our history, that there is something private as well as public about much of these historical records. What the current push is on about between the relationship between the royals and Germany, between the Second World Wars, and also recent child abuse scandals. So that's the logistical issues that I had. It made me realise that this is very much a live history, that this is very much something that remains contested, secrets remain, and it's all over the heart of the tiny queen who ruled for almost a century, or for 64 years. It feels like a century once you finish the book. And today we are grappling so much with questions of women and power. It gives us all the more reason to expose and rescue from history those who've been buried in plain sight. Victoria inherited power. And I think because of this, she's always been seen not as someone who championed what a woman could do in the public sphere. And indeed, she said suffragettes deserved a spanking. But at no time would she resile from any exercise of power herself. She would say, I don't believe women should be in the public sphere, but you will not be Prime Minister, you will not be in the Cabinet, and if you don't send more troops to the war, I'm going to Australia, which was the worst possible consequence of I think we need to... But she fought for her role in a way that is little understood. When she was a teenager, she reached for it firmly. This was part teenage rebellion. Can you imagine that she didn't just get her driver's license, she got a kingdom, and she could move her bed out of her mother's room. She could banish, effectively, John Conroy, her mother's advisor, who had tried to bully her when she was a teenager and set in train that steel kind of in her soul, which gave her so much resilience and so much robustness. She always fought to be consulted. She insisted no correspondence go through the country. Again, I know this is alarming to a Republican heart, but I was surprised to see how vigorously she'd exercised her powers. And over a century, when we're moving towards suffrage and a constitutional monarchy, how much she insisted on her own role, her own rights, and the centrality of her presence and some of the key decisions in British history. I think we need to acknowledge this to be able to more fully recognise the contributions of women in the political sphere today. Now, in many ways, Victoria was a singular and unusual woman. Her secretary, Arthur Ponsonby, wrote, "Queen Victoria did not belong to any conceivable category of monarchs or of women. She bore no resemblance to an aristocratic English lady. She bore no resemblance to a wealthy middle-class Englishwoman, nor to any typical princess of a German court. She reigned longer than the other three queens before her put together. Never in her life could she be confused with anyone else, nor will she be in history. Such expressions as people like Queen Victoria or that sort of woman could not be used about her. For over 60 years, she was simply without prefix or suffix, the Queen. A queen, you'll be happy to discover, was also a red-blooded woman." Thank you. I think I'm taking questions from the floor. Archives. archives in Scotland, in Oxford, which are fantastic. You have to actually put your hand on your heart and swear that you won't burn anything inside them when you are into these archives, even today. Where a man on his, a priest on his deathbed said, told someone who told someone else who wrote down and said that he'd married them and he wanted to confess that he was guilty about it. There's no other evidence of it. There's only ever rumour. All we can know that it's just, it was a level of intimacy that was, I was going to say unparalleled, but it was actually paralleled. That she loved him in a different way. I think that Albert to her was this godlike creature. I think the Albert Memorial in Hyde Park is very much how she saw him. Strong thighs, veering up into the heavens. John Brown, was a servant who made her laugh and carried her about the streams of very physical presence. Oh my gosh, absolutely. I wasn't able to find out which finger it was on. But the fact that, and also his handkerchief was on the middle, Albert's handkerchief and John Brown's handkerchief were both lying on her middle. So someone made that case. I can only go on the evidence that we've got, and the evidence is of a very powerful and enduring love for him.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, Victoria absolutely blamed him for Albert's death, even though Albert had Albert was only 42 when he died. Right. But it's put down to Crohn's disease. Now, there's long been a debate about whether that was typhoid. It certainly wasn't his son. He also worked himself to a point where he was constantly exhausted and depleted, Albert did. Victoria's greatest wish for every single one of her children was that they should all be like Albert. And the fact that the then Prince of Wales was genial, quite good company, not at all schoolish, and himself had the odd combustible as a child, was a source of great frustration for her. So, and the same with Albert, the future king, and they wanted him to be cerebral. They actually had his skull inspected for any defects. So his, Bertie was a rebellious creature who gambled and caroused, but actually as a king recognised things that his mother never had, which is the importance of public ceremony, and he kind of threw himself into more of a public ceremonial role than his mother had. So it was unfortunate that she blamed him. But after several years, they did achieve some kind of rapprochement. But it's of note that she never exceeded any responsibilities or duties to him. And I think that was a mistake. She kind of stymied, he became a playboy, but she had stymied his opportunity to really grow within those kinds of responsibilities. And when he travelled throughout the world, and in New York, the floor of a ballroom collapsed, the newspapers reported that because everyone had crowded to see him with such great excitement. But he was a great success. He went through India and he went to America, and he was really very well liked. And Victoria was quite sure that, yes, they liked him very much, but surely they would have preferred her. She got a little bit jealous, actually, towards the end. Yes, well, of course, and the last thing she did, one of the last things she did before she died was to sign the Federation of Australia and make us into a Commonwealth, which is of some excitement to us. her experience during the Crimean War had made her incredibly cautious when it came to war. She was very strongly pro-empire, along with Disraeli, but was concerned about the grab for Africa. And she was always concerned about what happened to what she called the native people. And when they went off to the Crimean War, she was full of glory and hope. And I wish I myself could ride off to war and be a soldier and kind of conquer and get those nasty Russians. And when It turned out to be an absolute unmitigated disaster in terms of care for the soldiers. Despite the constant lies that her generals told her about how merry it was to die in the fields, and everyone said that they were thrilled just before gasping their, you know, their last breath. When it turned out they didn't even have bandages there, Florence Nightingale went over, and it was notoriously unkempt and in a great deal of disarray. She writes in great detail about the soldiers returning from that war, in kind of poetic detail, actually, about scars and missing limbs, about empty sleeves and legs. And from then on, her primary concern was that if they were to go to war, and she was strongly against it when it came to involvement in the wars regarding Italy and the unification of Germany, the Prussian-Italian wars. She tried to ensure that people that it was properly resourced. So she would act as a break, and the editors of her letters say that she and Albert really were responsible for the fact that there wasn't more involvement in European conflicts in the 1850s. Demanded that things would be told to her all the time. When it came to, so were you talking about medical or political?
Both.
Medical. The lack of information about women's bodies, and you see that playing out in her own life, is fascinating, because you only get the odd glimpse. Albert told her to stop complaining about what pregnancies meant physically to her, and that she should pray, and if she prayed, it would not bother her so much. But she was found on her bed to have a prolapse and a ventral hernia, which may have been, which to me, look, not much is made of that for reasons of decorum and discretion. But honestly, that explained to me so much of the last decade or two of her life, when she grew to rely on the men that carried her, that physically could lift her from room to room. And it was her strong Indian servants who she wanted to help with her burial as well, and it was also John Brown. She only had anaesthetics with her second last child that was administered to it, and Albert is the one that found out about that. Albert, the true polymath. And she was so thrilled, she called it blessed, and her having it meant that that became a respectable practice. And the doctor that administered it to her, his first patient to have it, which had been not long before, was so thrilled that he called, that she called her child anaesthesia. So, yes, much was hidden. And no doctor ever examined her in the later part of her life. Although, when she was pregnant, one doctor was appalled at her, what he said was her frankness about her body. So, that's a very rare account of the time. In terms of things being kept from her, it wasn't that secrets were kept, it was that she was spun accounts and narratives that were clearly untrue, that she wanted to believe, especially about the conduct of war. And some of the imperial conflicts as well. Yes. Let's go to the first of your points regarding her not wanting to appear in public and be too. I think it was an assertion of control, and to be honest, she got terribly indulgent at some point. I had so much empathy for her when after Albert died, and I felt that she'd been castigated as a widow, but when you really look at the role of a widow in Victorian society, how they then had to retreat, they then lost status, how they lost income, how they weren't supposed to work. And she made being a widow kind of fabulous. She was just going to do it spectacularly if she was, and insist on her right to mourn as long as she could, and wear widow's weeds as long as she could. But I became convinced that she did have some kind of social phobia at that time. She hated eyes upon her. She hated being looked at. And I also thought she was a candidate for, in the DSM, grief is not included as a mental disorder because we don't want to pathologize grief. But there's an appendix for protracted grief, or prolonged grief. And those who are most susceptible to it lose a parent at an early age, have been bullied as a child, come to believe that their partner is absolutely everything to her, to them. And she said that Albert was her husband, her daughter, her sister, her partner, her mother, her everything. So that's part of why she grieved so long and so noisily. And she was convinced that she would throw up, actually, if she appeared in public. And so there was discussions amongst cabinet ministers, what do we do if the Queen vomits? and so they wouldn't ask her. But the suffragettes, it was this great contradiction because the suffragettes viewed her as an iconic figure towards the end of her life and the end of her reign. And she, H.G. Wells talks about his mother getting around, dressing like Victoria, wearing a bonnet like Victoria, and kind of having that assertion and having that that strength. Suffragettes reported, you know, trying to looking into her face, Katie Stanton, seeing her face and being strengthened by it. And Emily Davison, who threw herself under the King's horse and was a martyr of the first wave women's movement, she'd written to the Times just a few months before that, saying, you're all talking about women's work, what women can or can't do, what women may be capable of or not, but look at the Queen. And what I thought was remarkably prescient and insightful, because this really didn't come out to her, letters came out to the 1960s. She said, you can see the memos she writes, you can see her working every day, you can see her meetings with ministers and the correspondence, and she tried to really claim her as a powerful working woman. And not just that, a powerful, you know, working mother, which is in many ways how not they saw it, even though she said that for a woman to walk down the aisle was like a lamb to the slaughter. because of what it would mean to have children. She was full of contradictions, and that was what makes her fascinating. I think I might have gone on too long. I'm so sorry, but thank you very much.